Oceanside Community Church. If I haven't met you yet, my name is Lydia. I'm one of the pastors here and want to extend a welcome as well to those who are watching on the live stream. It's good to see you and be with you all virtually. Thank you for your flexibility, everyone, in coming to move indoors. I thought that would be the most health conscious thing to do in light of the smoke. So a couple things, if you would like even more space than what we can offer you here in the sanctuary, feel free to sit on the white chairs out in the lobby. That just allows you to have even a bit more space. If you've only been going to the outdoors and you haven't yet come to an indoor service, we sing with masks on out of honor for one another to not spread COVID-19 accidentally. And so we ask you to wear a mask while you sing. If you choose, you can wear it for the entire service as well. Let me open our time as I invite you to stand and prepare your hearts and your spirits for worship. In just a minute, Hannah is going to preach our final sermon in Summer in the Psalms with a sermon on what it means to give thanks to the Lord for who He is. And in one of those Thanksgiving Psalms, Psalm 16, David, after praying to the Lord to keep him safe and thanking the Lord for who He is, at the end, he says, "You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand." Jesus, you make known to us the path of life. You fill us with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Jesus, we thank you that you are eternal and that not only do you save us, but you give us joy and you fill our life with pleasure. Pleasure that is holy, pleasure that is pure, pleasure that is childlike. And so, Lord, we want to dive deep into the pleasures and the riches and the glory of Jesus. We want to do that corporately in our worship of you. So would you be with us by your Spirit, Jesus? We pray that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. Fill us with joy and fill us with yourself, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Would you worship with us?
All right. Worship the Lord.
We will feel the night. We will walk the valley with
Praise the Lord. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Never failed me yet. Never failed me
the darkness.
the Apostle Paul reminds us, and more than reminds us, commands us to make our requests known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so right now we're going to do that together. We're going to pray into some very specific things, making our requests known to God. If you feel like sitting, you can do so, and I'm going to ask you to engage in your minds and your hearts and your words in praying together. And so first and foremost, Jesus, we do long and bring our hearts and our worries and our cares and our concern for the fires to you, God. Lord, we ask for rain to be poured out in the Pacific Northwest, that you would send in the rain, Jesus. We ask for the protection for the many homes and lives and souls who have had to evacuate in California and Oregon. Lord, would you protect them? Give safety and peace to their hearts. We pray for the many people who have welcomed the stranger into their home. Lord, that there would be peace in those homes, yeah, and that you would bless those who have opened their homes. Lord, we pray for the firefighters, that you would guard them, protect them, keep their lungs safe in this. Give wisdom to the fire chiefs and those who are making decisions on how to fight these fires, Lord. We pray for those with respiratory concerns, with asthma, with aging lungs, Lord. The many, even in our own community, who are afraid to go outside even right now, Lord, we pray that you would guard and protect their physical beings and their mental health as well, Jesus. Lord, we know that you are capable and able to send rain. So we ask, if it be your will, that you would send the rains, Jesus. Also want to pray into the school year coming up. And I want to invite you, church, to join in prayer with me. I may be praying words, and you can be adding your yes and amen. But you can also feel free to just pray out, even from your seat quietly, as I lead us through some prayers. There's three people groups, if you will, that I want us to specifically let our hearts be united in prayer for. And if you're comfortable, I'm going to ask, if you are in one of those groups, that you could just stand up so people can recognize you and pray for you. And so the first is any students who are going back to school this week. And that could be elementary school or all the way up to university. We would love to pray for you. And so we want to lift them up to you right now, Father. We pray for things that we maybe wouldn't normally pray for at the beginning of a school year. We pray for resilience. We pray for faith. We pray for trust. We pray for maturity beyond years that can withstand and endure difficult times. Lord, we pray for these students' mental and emotional and spiritual and physical health as they go to school, that it would not be a place where they digress in their learning through the pandemic, but through the hardship of having to do school so differently, that they would grow in their faith, grow in their mind, grow in their spirit. Lord, we pray that this school year would be a year that marks for them a year where they had to lean into you and trust you day by day, perhaps trusting you in the midst of anxiety, in the midst of questions, frustration, even anger, Lord. We pray that in spite of difficulties, that you would work through these students. Lord, keep them safe. We pray that this would be a time where they grow in their mind, in their body, and their spirit. And next, if you are a parent, or a family member of a student that lives with you or something like that, perhaps a guardian, would you stand up? We would love to pray for you. And so, Lord, we ask your blessing to be on the parents, whether they are educating at home, sending their children to the schools, doing a mix of both, or perhaps even just wondering how to work all of this out, Lord. We ask, as your brother James commanded us and encouraged us, to ask for wisdom from the God of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. We ask for the gift of wisdom to be given to these parents, as they take care of their children day by day in whatever mode and whatever decisions and choices their family went with in the pandemic. Lord, we pray that you would give them peace. Lord, we pray that you would fill the parents with endurance and perseverance. We also ask for the gift of faith to be given to the parents, that they can be cheerleaders and encouragers, and even in the midst of this pandemic, be disciplers of their children. Lord, would you give great boldness to these parents to disciple them, the children, in what it means to have faith in times like this, what it means to be a light in times like this, what it means to be bold and to have endurance in times like these. So give your wisdom and give your faith to the parents, we pray. And lastly, if you are a teacher, or if you work in the schools in any way, when maybe you drive bus or are a custodian, if you would stand, and we would love to pray for you as well. And Jesus, I want to specifically bring, I think it's five people that I know of for sure, that are teachers or work in schools. And so we collectively bring Paul and Karen and Brent and Rebecca and Joanne to you, our dear brothers and sisters who teach and are so such selfless love at the schools, Lord. Would you give them a special blessing of your presence, your spirit resting upon them? We pray for joy, joy that does not diminish, joy that is not here and there, but joy that sustains them day by day as they teach and as they give of themselves. Lord, we pray for the gifts of creativity and spontaneity and ingenuity to be upon them. For those who perhaps are working especially with children with special needs in this time, Lord, we pray that they would have faith and that they would have grace upon them and that they would be able to be a sense of strongness and strength and compassion to children with special needs who may especially have a hard time understanding what's happening in our world right now. Lord, we pray that you would give all the teachers in District 69 your wisdom, your grace. We pray specifically for Principal Sheila at the Arrington Elementary School, with whom we have partnership, that your blessing would be upon her and that her school would be a place of safety and joy for elementary children. So Lord, we again come back to the words of Paul, who said, "Let your requests be made known unto God." We've made our requests known to you, and we right now at the start of the school year want to receive the peace which passes understanding and which will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Peace not that the world gives. Peace not that the world can take away. Peace that lasts. Peace that is true. Peace that is forward leaning. And peace that sustains us day by day. We thank you for your peace. Jesus, we receive your peace. In Christ's name we pray, for his sake. Amen. Thank you for engaging with the heart of God collectively in corporate worship through prayer and through the worship service. And thank you to Jerry and Ian and Barry and Rio for leading us in music. That was really beautiful, guys. Well, I want to say welcome to you, and if this is perhaps one of your first times at Oceanside, or you're just getting to know us, we would love to get to know you more. The pastors, we love it being a small enough church where we can actually have a relationship with you, and so to help us in that, we would ask you to fill out a connection card. We normally do that with paper and pen, but in the pandemic, we've moved it to just online to lessen any germs and all that stuff. So you can go to OceansideCommunityChurch.ca and please just fill in the connection card that you'll see in the front where you put your name and some contact info, and so pastors and the church as a whole can get to know you as well. I have just a couple announcements for all of you this afternoon, and the first one is around the Arrington Elementary Breakfast Program. We will be relaunching this program. It will be pivoted and tilted. We're still working on the details of what that looks like, But Principal Sheila actually contacted us and said, I still really want to do this. I've got the regulations in place. We've got to work out the details. So what it is we serve breakfast every morning to children in need. There's about 20 children at Arrington Elementary who would not have breakfast if we at all provided for them if we didn't do this. And so we're really honored and pleased to partner with the school and to bless them in this way. So we have volunteers that come usually once a week. You sign up for one day. Some do it more, but most will do it one day. And it's about from 7:30 until the first bell at 8:15. If this is something that interests you, please talk to me. You can email me, you can call me, or just visit with me in person, and I'd love to share more with you about the program and hopefully get you hooked up into it. The next announcement is around our life groups, which will also be relaunching in October. If you are part of a life group right now, you'll be hearing from your leaders shortly with some details, maybe even some questions around your comfort levels and what your needs may be in the pandemic. We have received official word from Dr. Henry around small groups, and she does encourage them in the homes if you can practice physical distancing. And so the life groups will be launching in person. Some of them will be meeting here in the church because the church is so much bigger and able to accommodate people being quite far apart. So be in touch with your leader if you are part of a group. If you're not part of a group, we have space in some of the ones that are already running, and we also are launching two more, one in Parksville and one in Qualicum Beach. So again, get in touch with me if you would like to join one of those groups. Well, the third announcement is an exciting one regarding what are we going to be doing come fall with our church services. So the pastoral staff took over a week to really pray privately and together, discerning the Spirit of the Lord on what to do and asking for wisdom. We were also able to be on a conference call with Dr. Henry and Premier Corgan for faith leaders around a lot of questions about where the pandemic is right now and what that means for faith leaders and how we do church or synagogue or mosques, whatever the case may be. So we did that, and there were new regulations that came out that we read, and as you know, Joseph would have read them to the finest detail, which is great. And so all of that combined, we discovered a couple things. We are now, at this time of the pandemic, able to host two meetings simultaneously in the church building, so long as people don't interact with each other. So they said if you have separate entrances and people can come and go without having a great big blob of people in the middle, go for it. And we were like, hey, we've got the multi-purpose room and the sanctuary. We can do that. So we had all of this information in place, and then as we were praying as the pastoral staff, we felt the Lord leading us to be bold and to have faith in these times. And what that looked like specifically was adding another service for families to make a lot of space and availability for families. So we're going to have two family services starting in October at 9 a.m., so same as us always been going, and at 11 a.m. They'll be identical, but it gives families more options and it leaves more space for families. So when that family service is running at 11 a.m., simultaneously, the general worship service, which was the indoor service, we're just calling it the general worship service now, will be running at the same time right in here at 11 a.m. for adults. And then lastly, our 4 p.m. service, as much as we would maybe love to meet in the rain and in the dark and in the cold, it just doesn't sound like quite so much fun. We didn't want to mix it though. We really felt that there was a special thing going on with the 4 p.m. service and that it was a time that worked well. Excuse me, I don't have COVID. I think. I've just been talking a lot. That worked well for people, and we did not want to just get rid of that. And so we are going to keep the 4 p.m. service in October. We're just going to move it indoors here, which is basically what we're doing right now. So Lord willing, if the air quality is good for the rest of September, we will continue meeting outdoors, and then we'll move indoors once the rain and the darkness has settled in. So those are the announcements I have for you. And lastly, I just want to thank you and encourage you to continue to partner with the Lord in His church, in His gospel, in His ministry that's happening locally here in Oceanside through your givings of your monies. So you can do that either old-fashioned way through cash and check in envelopes, and there is a silver giving box right back there by Dan, Or you can do it in modern ways through our website. You can give via credit card or e-transfers, and you can also even give through texting on your mobile phone. So those options and how to do all that is clearly laid out for us on the website, which I commend to you for giving. This time, I'm done talking, and Hannah's gonna come up and give a word. Well, hello everyone. It's good to see you this evening. Wow, this is pretty cool to see all of you in the same room. I think I need a minute. Love you all so much, and it's pretty cool. We've been celebrating church together and worshiping together, but to be in the same room is pretty special, and thanks for being here today. It is my privilege to speak to you this afternoon and evening in our closing sermon of our Summer in the Psalms series. And our topic today is Psalms of Thanksgiving. Did anybody make it all the way through the reading list that you were given earlier this summer for the Psalms? Anybody get somewhat through it? Does anybody read some of the Psalms? Yes, yes. I didn't get all the way through it either, but I hope you spent some time being able to read some of the Psalms on these topics. The last one being Thanksgiving. So as I was looking through them, and I did read through, don't worry, I did read through all the Psalms of Thanksgiving. As I was looking through them, I noticed a pattern. And I want to share that pattern with you today. And I suggest that this pattern is something to meditate on, not just as like, oh, this is cool that this is in Scripture, but as a pattern for our own lives. And it goes like this in these Psalms. So the person in the Psalm is in trouble of some sort. And maybe it's they're in poor health, they're experiencing conflict from the outside, they might have inner turmoil or fear or sin. And in these Psalms, the person cries out to God. As a result, God delivers and he comes to the rescue. And then the person thanks God. So the person cries out, God delivers, and then the person gives thanks to God. So we're going to read one of these Psalms, and you'll find it on your chair. If you don't have one, there are still a couple around that haven't been touched. This is Psalm 107, if you're following with us online. It's Psalm 107, 1 through 32. And you'll see a slightly more bold print on here, and we'll read all of that together. I'm going to ask Lydia to come right back up again and to read with me. Can you give Lydia a hand? She's been everything today, including doing stuff. So we're going to read this together. Would you stand with us, please, as we read the word of the Lord? Psalm 107, 1 through 32. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. Those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south.
Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away.
Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for humankind. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things.
Some sat in darkness, in utter darkness, prisoners suffering in iron chains because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the plans of the Most High. So he subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help.
Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness, the utter darkness, and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for humankind, for he breaks down gates of bronze and cuts through bars of iron.
Some became fools through their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquities. They loathed all food and drew near the gates of death.
Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for humankind.
and tell of his works with songs of joy.
Some went out on the sea in ships. They were merchants on the mighty waters. They saw the works of the Lord, his wonderful deeds in the deep. For he spoke and stirred up a tempest that lifted high the waves. They mounted up to the heavens and went down to the depths. In their peril, their courage melted away. They reeled and staggered like drunkards. They were at their wits' end.
Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper. The waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven.
Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for humankind. Let them exalt him in the assembly of the people and praise him in the council of the elders.
Amen. You may be seated. So did you see this pattern? It came four times, actually, in this psalm. People were in trouble. We saw different kinds of trouble. They cried out to the Lord every time he delivered them. And then they gave thanks, sometimes on their own, sometimes in the assembly of the people. So this is not just something interesting to notice in the beautiful writing of these poems. It's a pattern for our lives. Because Jesus told us that we would have trouble in this world, and we have many kinds of trouble. When we do, God wants us to cry out to him, to see him deliver us, and then to give thanks. You know, God always delivers us. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. He's our shepherd. He gives us everything that we need. But interestingly, we don't always do what is written in this psalm. We often decide not to cry out, and we do not live in continual thankfulness. So I'm going to spend the rest of our time exploring those two things together so that we can be aware of our behavior and ask the Lord to help change it. So my first question today is, why don't we cry out to the Lord? I mean, when we're in trouble, sometimes we cry out, but sometimes we don't. And one of the reasons is that we don't always have confidence in his power. So that we need confidence in his power, confidence in his love in order to cry out to him. And by we, I do mean me. So I've been struggling with mild but chronic pain in my ankle for maybe 2 years. And I've prayed about it here and there, maybe half-heartedly, but I really have not cried out to the Lord. And really, I have to look at myself and realize that's the sin of unbelief, of saying, well, Lord, I don't know if I have the faith for you to heal me. I've been afraid to ask him, and I need to cultivate my faith, and there are some ways we can do that. I can do that by reading scripture. Something my dad always did is he would specifically read the stories of Jesus healing people in the Gospels. And there are a lot of them. You just watch Jesus and he's like, this person, yeah, you're healed. These many people, yeah, you're healed. Over and over and over again. And it builds your faith because that same Jesus who was there back then is here with us now and wants to heal us. I also can bolster my faith by listening to testimony from other people of what God has done for them. And they might not just offer that to me. I might actually have to ask them, hey, what has God been doing in your life? That's an important question to ask. Because when we hear the answer to that, it builds our faith, because God's always working. When it builds our faith, we pray better. When we pray better, we end up with a story to encourage others. So we can ask these questions. What is God doing in your life? How is God working in your life right now? Sometimes we don't cry out because we don't actually have confidence in his love. We know he's great. We know he's powerful. But we're not sure if he cares. And I suggest today that that's unbelief too, because scripture makes it abundantly clear that God loves us, that he cares for us, that he cares about every detail of our lives. And there are so many times in scripture that he says, if you want something, if you need something, tell me. If you're worried about something, tell me. God is often described as our Father, and in Matthew 7:11, says, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So I love giving gifts to my kids. I bought some special art supplies for Junia for her third birthday. It's coming up, so don't tell her about it. But I I can't wait to see her face when she opens them. Anya, my older daughter, this maybe past couple of weeks has kind of been mentioning the specific kind of bubble gum that she wanted, just offhand, not necessarily like saying, Mom, can you get it for me? But one night, we just went to Quality Foods after the other kids went to bed and we picked it up for her, and it was such a delight for me to do that. I get really satisfied when I can give my kids what they want sometimes, or what they need, like when I can provide the shoes and the rain boots that they need to be able to play the things that they like to play outside. And you all know God is a much, much, much better parent than you are or I am or anyone. He's better than our wildest dreams. So we are meant to cry out to him for what we need. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God.
Amen.
So that's kind of why sometimes we don't cry out to him, but sometimes we also don't thank him. And I suggest that's for the same two reasons, that we lack confidence in God's power and we lack confidence in his love. So in order to give thanks to the Lord, we actually need confidence that he's the one who did it, that he's sovereign, that every good and perfect gift comes from him, whether it's salvation itself, or a fireside conversation with a friend, or a good day at work, or a favorable verdict in a court case. Whatever it is, it comes from him, and we can thank him for it. I've always said, I am so grateful to have someone to be grateful to. I'll say that again. I know you're a little sleepy. I'm so grateful to have someone to be grateful to. I think there's an innate impulse in the world around us to recognize that it's good to be a grateful person. You'll see things like even on Facebook, like I'm grateful to the universe. We know that there's this thankfulness welling up inside of us. I remember sitting in my baby group, and like a public health baby group, and they were kind of going in the right direction, and they were actually spending time saying, like, you need to teach your kids how to be grateful for the things in life, not just to you, but just to be grateful. And I was sitting there and agreeing, yeah, like that's really important, but there's this giant, invisible, spiritual elephant in the room saying, who are we grateful to? You can't just be grateful in general, you're grateful to someone, and that's to God. That's to the one who gives us every good and every perfect gift. So if you have stable finances right now, don't look down on others who don't. Thank the Lord for them. Do you have strong family relationships? Well, we can't take all the credit. We thank the Lord for them. Have you perhaps made some really big, healthy life changes lately, and other people notice and ask you about it? Well, when they ask you about it, praise the Lord, because it came from him. As Paul says, what do you have that you did not receive from God? When we thank him, we're acknowledging his power. We're acknowledging his sovereignty over every single aspect of our lives. In him we live, in him we move, in him we have our being. But lastly, in order to thank him, we need faith in his love. We need to know that he cares for us and that he's not a fickle God who's going to change his mind if we mention it. Some of us, let's be honest, are afraid that this is how it will go. You say, like, thanks, Lord, for this job. I really like it. It's very fulfilling. And the Lord's going to be like, yeah, so now that you mention it, I think I've been giving you too many good things lately. That's got to stop. Does anyone else have that fear? Does anyone else feel that inside of them? Sometimes it's called other shoe theology. You're waiting for the other shoe to drop. But it's terrible theology, and I should know because I experience it. And I let that fear keep me from being thankful. I'm afraid to thank the Lord because I feel like, well, then he's going to notice he's given me too many good things and he's just going to take them away. That's not our God, is it? That's the enemy lying to me and not even letting me receive the gifts that he's given to me. So someone I know has the really awesome, life-giving, joy-growing habit of going through the day and just thanking the Lord for everything, every gift that this person has given. My son called me. Thank you, Lord. The bus isn't full today. Thank you, Lord. I solved my computer problem. Thank you, Lord. The stock market's going back up. Thanks, Lord. My dog is eating again today. Thank you, Lord. We can thank him for all of these things, and it's not because our Father in heaven needs us to check some sort of box by saying thank you. When Junia opens my gift on her third birthday, I do hope that she thanks me. And that's not because I like, you know, I won't love her if she doesn't say thank you. It's because I want to know that she sees my love through what I've given to her. The Lord loves us. He's going to respond better to us than the very best parent. And not only that, but if for any reason I lose these things that I'm grateful for, if I lose my health, if I lose my good friend, my financial security, if I lose my job that I love, if I lose peace in my family, I can continue to give thanks in every circumstance because in the Lord, I lack nothing. I'm a child of God. I have redemption through his blood. I am thankful for the gift of God that is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I look forward to the riches of his glorious inheritance with all the saints when we will join every creature in heaven and on earth. And we'll say to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Thank you, Lord. But that starts now. We have no excuse not to continually give thanks to the Lord. It's good for us. I'm going to show you a 2-minute video from Luke 17. Now, this is a video that I initially found for the family service, and I'm just going to tell you, this is a real story, but it is played by Lego figures. So you're gonna have to do a little translation in your head. But when I saw it and I was gonna use it for the kids, I realized that it's actually really profound and I wanted to show it to you today. So 2-minute video, go ahead and watch this.
I was, you know, looking
through one last psalm, and this verse just stood out to me. The Lord was like, this is what I want you to learn. In case you haven't noticed it, power belongs to you, God, and with you, Lord, is unfailing love.
Amen.
Would you stand with me? I'm going to spend some time not just thinking about crying out to the Lord, but spend a few minutes. Probably something, honestly, has already surfaced in your mind, something that you want to cry out to the Lord for. So the musicians are going to support us musically in prayer. And I'm just going to lead us through some prayers from Psalm 107, and we'll close after that with the Psalm of Thanksgiving and a benediction. So Lord, we cry out to you. We believe in your power. We believe in your love. And Lord, if we don't believe, we can say like the disciples, Lord, help our unbelief, because it's your spirit that gives us faith. So let your faith arise today, Lord, inside of us. Lord, whatever it is that has surfaced that we needed to cry out for, trouble in our lives, someone else's lives, Lord, we cry out in faith. So go ahead and do that. You can even do so out loud. You can cry out for what the Lord has put on your heart. Lord, some today are in a desert or a wilderness, and they're feeling perhaps lost, hungry, and thirsty. Bring your deliverance, Lord. Lead them by a straight way. You satisfy the thirsty, you fill the hungry with good things. Lord, some today sit in darkness. Perhaps it's us, perhaps it's people we know. Prisoners suffering in iron chains. And Lord, we ask that you would bring them out of that darkness, and you would break down the gates of bronze, that you would cut through the bars of iron, as we know that you can. Lord, some are suffering trouble today because of their own rebellious ways, because of the choices perhaps they have made. But that's not beyond you, Lord, and you don't leave us to our own consequences. So Lord, we ask that you would bring them out of their distress, that you would rescue them from the grave, that you would send out your word and heal them, because that's what you do. And Lord, finally, some today are in the midst of chaos, and it feels like the sea is overwhelming them. Perhaps that's something to do with their work or their family, or it could be something internal. But Lord, you are the one who showed your disciples that you can calm the sea. You stilled the storm with a whisper, and you said, peace be still. We claim that peace. We claim your peace and your deliverance, Lord. And we say thank you. We give thanks to you for your unfailing love, your goodness to us. Give us faith to ask, give us faith to thank you. Let's sing this song together. It may not be familiar via the words, but the tune will be. And it's a song of thanksgiving to the Lord. If you are going to sing, please wear your mask. Thank you.
Your mercy, your
Grace to all who